I'm Matthew McLendon. I'm the curator of modern and contemporary art at the John and Mabel Ringling Museum of Art in Sarasota, Florida. And today I am in the studio of Rob Tarbell. We're almost up to December, which means that we'll both be going down to Miami for the craziness that is Art Basel Miami. You'll be showing new work from the series All Ages, right? Yes.
All Ages is the rock and roll, kind of punk rock vein.
Right, and this really comes out of your personal history, doesn't it?
Yes, I have early high school years creating flyers for bands that existed, mine, real bands, and also some that didn't, just fictional, hopeful bands.
That was a very low-tech experience, creating the types of flyers and zines. So can you speak a little bit about that?
The collage aspect, hunting, finding the right size photo or text, whatever, clipping, copying, or pasting, and then the copying side of it to get the perfect sort of black or making something work at all. The copier was
right. Nasty. So this was literal cut and pasting. This wasn't word process cut and pasting.
Glue, you were glue, tape,
your X-Acto knife. Yep. Right. So talk to me a little bit about how that process, of, in which there's a great deal of chance, really speaks to the current process you're using of silk screening and smoke to produce your images.
The biggest connection is kind of just the grays, the blacks, the whites, and trying to figure out how to make those communicate the image. With the Xerox machine, you are never guaranteed anything. Whatever, the black could have been terrible. And the same thing is with the technological sort of silk screen. It should guarantee the same thing over and over, but the way I'm using it, it doesn't. The smoke is the wild card. Actually, the heat, the flame is the wild card.
Right.
So the flame can destroy everything. And I never know what I'm gonna get. There's a huge element of like, will it work at all?
Sure. What are you using to produce that smoke?
Burning 35 millimeter slides of my work and also works from art survey courses. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of infused with my past and the
whole past of Western art history.
Yeah, sure. Neanderthal Greek pottery, goes on and on and on.
Right.
So everything.
And so what's the source material for the imagery that you're using in this series?
Images that I took that fit that somehow, which I like the time machine aspect of it. I collected a lot of imagery from eBay from those years, Time magazines, National Enquirers.
We're talking mid-80s.
Mid-80s, yep. Cosmopolitans and some kind of bizarre other magazines that I'd never heard of. Stuff that would have been available. And using my sort of sensibilities now, looking back, but also trying to think with my brain from then.
Right.
But like using John Travolta, who was kind of a big icon, with Farrah Fawcett, riffing on feathered hair.
Which wasn't necessarily, I mean, John Travolta and Farrah Fawcett weren't associated with the punk scene, so you're kind of appropriating that imagery into a punk vocabulary.
Right, right, cutting and pasting. I mean, there's a long tradition of taking Ronald Reagan and making Hitler.
Exactly,
and
Margaret Thatcher.
Margaret Thatcher, right. So there was that aspect, but I didn't want to go down that same road. It was me kind of looking back and playing with the imagery and the archetypes that were available then and how they look at them now.
And so there's a great deal of kind of interest in fame as well. I mean, with the punk scene, there was a very localized, centralized type of fame, underground fame. But you're kind of expanding that a bit with this series.
There's the local side with the local kind of heroes. Then there's the punk kind of heroes. I couldn't even think of,
The Clash and and there's the Debbie Harry image. So you have you have an image that you call Debbie.
Right. It was a current sort of sale of a look that she had done years ago. It wasn't even one I remember at all, and I thought that was probably what stuck out. But it recreated that.
Right, a contemporary recreation of the Debbie brand in a way.
And there's that emulation to it. And then in sort of presenting it as the Debbie look, it became recognized as Debbie.
Right.
As much as I corrected and said, not Debbie, it is Debbie.
And so that really speaks to our desire to recognize fame and to associate with fame. And that goes into another series that we can maybe touch on, which is Failure to Appear.
Right.
And we have that, behind us here, just two of the latest iterations of that series. And that came out of your working with actual police mugshot imagery.
A publication that collected all the current mugshots.
Right. In Charlottesville, Virginia, where you were living.
Probably the 10 counties around Charlottesville, okay. And around, so kind of a cross-section of communities. When reading it, someone came and tapped me on the shoulder and said, "Do you want to see my picture?"
Right.
And it was kind of shocking. And they showed me, and there was this sort of pride in showing you that they made it, even though it was for like public drunkenness.
Right, so it's that slippage between fame and infamy. Right. And now you've moved on from that. You're not using specifically police mugshots, no. But you're taking other types of images and cropping them and enlarging them. This image behind us was taken from a larger photograph, but you've cropped it, you've enlarged it, you've particularized it, and that completely changes our reading.
It's that mugshot, that unflattering moment that can go either way. It's carrying its immediate past, and then you have a changed immediate future. It's that pivotal moment that I'm keying on. And once you go to the sort of unglamorized context, right. It associates to driver's license photos,
right.
Mugshot ones, and it's just a very, very straightforward presentation. So it has a context, an expectation, and people can read with it. And that's kind of fun. Like this one is probably the opposite of a mugshot. It's from a cruise.
Right, cruise photo.
And he gave it to me and I kind of worked on it. The old cut and paste occasioned us to do a progression. It is just the association of that format. Right. People say when you take a bad photo, oh, it looks like a mugshot.
And it's that moment, and you're playing around with the moment, which works perfectly with your technique using the smoke.
Right.
Because at any moment, the smoke can either work the way you're hoping it will work, or it can be a disaster.
Right, it's usually a sign of change.
Right.
And then that's what I like that association with magic. Mm-hmm. When you see the puff of smoke, the dove appeared. So no dove, and then suddenly it's changed. Or distraction, which I really like, that element of distraction to cloud the context, which I really like. And then you talk about clouds, suddenly smoke and clouding and the expectation, and all kind of fits in.
And you've worked yourself into this series now, haven't you?
I'm in it too. So with the Crime Times, it became a snapshot of the community. And while I haven't been arrested, I was suspected of something years ago when I was working at, I guess I can say at Kinko's. And I did the bank deposit and I went next door and it was winter, completely covered up, sunglasses, hat, coat. Went next door, never done a bank deposit before, and dropped the bank deposit, walked out, and then the next guy that walked in robbed the bank. And he was dressed just like I was. And so the next day I went to work, and the FBI was there waiting for me, because they had said it was the guy next door. So anyway, funny story.
So, the FBI had done a kind of composite image of you.
They did a composite of it, and it was published in the paper, and I got the original, and I've kept it all these years, so my image is one of these. I became part of that fabric of the community that was alleged and supposed.
But again, that slippage between what you see and what you want to see.
Yes.
Exactly.
Yes.
Great. Thanks, Rob.
Yep. Thank you.